Hey guys, welcome to the Prelims Focus News discussion of 1st September 2017. Let's see the very first news. It is about Handbook of State Statistics. See, basically this Handbook of State Statistics has been developed by Niti Aayog. All right. For the consolidation of key statistics across sector for every Indian states and union territories. See, different statistics in different areas like GDP, means gross state domestic product, then workers population ratio, unemployment ratio, etc. Means whatever has been written here. So earlier, up till now, all these data were fragmented in nature. Means these data were there with government, but with other different ministries. But after the conduction of this Handbook of State Statistics, everything will be, you know, in a single platform. And it will ultimately help the central, all the state government in future policy making to implement those policies in a much better and effective way, right? So that's why these are considered, this will be considered a crucial indicator for the fragmented across the different sources will be consolidated in a single place. I mean, all the fragmented data will be consolidated at a single place, and those data will be GSDP, that is gross state domestic product, labor statistics, labor force participation rate, workers population ratio, unemployment rates, data on education covers primary, secondary and tertiary levels, health, different health indicators like infant mortality rate, total fertility rate, birth rates, etc., and information regarding infrastructure development in the state. So this was about this Handbook of State Statistics. Next is about National Nutrition Week, which is being celebrated from 1st to 7th September, and it is the initiative of Ministry of Women and Child Development, remember, all right? And the theme is optimal infant and young child feeding practices for better child health, all right? And the aim of this National Nutrition Week is basically to intensify the generation of awareness for the nutrition, right? What is the importance of nutrition for health, for the development, productivity, economic growth, and ultimately national development? Because these are the sectors where our youth don't, I mean, the youth can't correlate that what is the importance of, you know, nutrition for the development of these sectors, right? So after the awareness generation, at least they will know, right? And also few workshops will be, you know, conducted in which there will be sensitization for the state and district level officers, and there will be capacity building so that they would also be coming to know that what are the, what kind of policies we should make so that this nutrition can be, you know, the nutritional focused policies can be brought about in states or different districts, right? Next is lecture and demonstrations will also be given especially to teachers, Anganwadi workers, helpers, and village women and Mahila Samitis, because these are the people who are directly related, some directly or indirectly related to the upliftment of the nutrition in the district or state level, right? And awareness generation on the weight management will also be there to the adolescent boys and girls, because adolescent is the age where the weight body mass index fluctuates, right? So through this awareness generation, they will at least know that what is the optimum level of body mass index we should keep in our body. And as such, I mean, if they are having more weight than their height, then they will at least do exercise to reduce that so that they remain fit, all right? So this is a few short of objectives under this national celebration of this National Nutrition Week. Next is about Food Processing Incubation Center. Guys, this has been launched at Perambadur, and for the reason of shallots. Now, shallots, what is this shallots? These are kind of onions, but these are not onions, remember, right? So I mean, this incubation center has been specifically developed for these production of shallots, because it is seen in Perambalur region of Tamil Nadu that shallots are being grown at huge numbers, right? So it is a kind of initiative, you can tell that, you know, it is an initiative to help the farmers' income by 2022, right? By through value addition, because incubation centers will, you know, keep these for a longer period of time, right? I'll show you in the next slide. See, these are kind of shallots which have normally the shelf month of, you know, 1 month, but if these are these are kept in an incubation center, or future some processing is done on it by to make it in convert it into onion powder or onion paste or dehydrated onion flakes, then the shelf life increases to 6 months, 5 months and 6 months respectively, right? So that's why this incubation center is being focused on these shallots, all right? And it will help increase the productivity in spite of the increasing difficulties in cultivation due to increase in price of inputs, unpredictable weather, disease outbreak and not getting adequate price in the market, all right? So this was about it. And farmers reported massive loss due to conventional methods of handling and storage. Earlier farmers used to, you know, complain about it, but after the formation of this, you know, setting up of this food processing incubation center, it is said that the farmers will be getting relieved, all right, and shallots will not be getting wasted and its availability to the consumers can be ensured. Okay, next is about Rajashwa Gyan Sangam, guys. It is basically an annual conference which is being conducted between Central Board of Direct Taxes and Central Board of Excise and Customs. All right, and the objective of this conference is to enable the two-way communication between the policymakers and other senior officials in the field office with a view to increase the revenue collections. Means they will just do communication that what are the ways through which they can increase the revenue collection in the government, right? And as such, I mean, they will take suggestions from different stakeholders associated, and you know, as such, they will implement such kind of laws which are to be needed to increase the revenue collection in an ethical way, right? Not non-ethically, like they will charge huge amount of you know, tax, not like that. They will charge it ethically only. All right, other issues discussed under this Rajashwa Gyan Sangams are HR issues, litigation management, strategies for revenue maximization, how to stop tax evasion, taxpayer services, can how it can be made more effective than GST and customs reforms what have been taking place nowadays. All right, so these are all the things which are being discussed under this Rajashwa Gyan Sangam. So it is becoming very important, guys. Alright, next is about aggregate measurement of support. So guys, it was a PIB news, and what is this aggregate measure of support? It is an amber box support which is being allotted to different countries, right? So why this was in news? Let's see. The context is joint proposal has been sent by India and China in WTO on aggregate measurement of support, that is amber box support, right? Now, why India and China has proposed this joint proposal for the rationalization of this amber box thing? Because it was seen that the facility under amber box which is being allotted to different countries, and it is being said that the limit of amber box can only be spent to the farmers of their respective countries. I mean, you can't invest more than the fund which is allotted under amber box subsidy. Otherwise, it is said that, you know, it can distort the world market. But it is seen that the if you see the amount in absolute term which is given under this amber box subsidy support thing, then you will observe that the rich countries give in absolute term, they give very much amount respectively to the developing and underdeveloped countries like India and China. That's why they are saying that you should rationalize this so that the trade which is in our context, it is getting distorted. All right, we can't give that much protection to our farmers as you give, right? So that's why it is said that it is calling for the elimination by the developed countries of the most trade distorting form of farm subsidies known as WTO parlance of amber box support as a prerequisite for consideration of other reforms in domestic support negotiations. See, if they will rationalize, then that what we can do is India and countries like India and China can, you know, we can reform our domestic support negotiations. All right, and it will ultimately, you know, help our farmers, because ultimately the mission of India is to, you know, double the farmers' income by 2022. So these are kind of, you know, steps being taken forth by our governments of developing countries, right? It counters the effort by some countries to target the subsidies of the developing countries while letting the developed countries retain their huge farm subsidies. That is what I have already explained to you, right? All right, next question is about China has been forced to abandon plan to enlarge BRICS in face of resistance from India and other BRICS countries, right? See, China was planning to, you know, increase this BRICS to BRICS plus countries, right? But countries like India and other countries of, you know, BRICS have, you know, they have said that no, we will not let you, you know, expand this, because expanding this will dilute our BRICS, right? Now, See, the country of BRICS are already mentioned in this map. You can see it. Now, what is the reason that China wanted to expand this? Because China want to, you know, bring countries like Pakistan, hai na, and other countries where China have their more influence. Now, see, since China will have their more influence, then it will be easier for China in future, you know, in bringing out future reforms under this BRICS. I mean, see, if Pakistan is included in China, now you see the context. Pakistan, the relations of Pakistan and India are not good, and you see in SAARC only that Pakistan is not letting any of the reforms to take place so smoothly in SAARC, right? And if it will come in BRICS also, then what will happen is, like, we'll face many difficulties, because China will tell that, okay, we want to bring this reform, but since earlier, you know, out of five members, we were you know, responding like, no, we will not let you bring this reform. Means 20% vote was there that we will not let you, means we don't want that reform to come if China wanted that reform to bring into the BRICS. I'm just giving an example right now. If, say, for example, other countries like Pakistan and puppets of China will come there, then what they will do is that they will tell that, okay, China is allowed to bring reform. But our percentage of saying no will get reduced. Now it's 20%. Otherwise, in future, it might get reduced to 15 or 10%. All right. So this is what the example just I've given you. That's it, to make you understand. Right. Now, the critic says that China want to expand the BRICS mechanism as a means to garner wider influence for itself. That's what I've make you understood. Right. So this was about this BRICS Plus plan, which has been proposed by China. But later, China has abandoned it. Right. Alright guys, so this was about today's news. We'll meet in next class. Till then, bye bye, take care, and thank you for listening to me guys. Thank you very much. And one more thing, the Hindi version of it is also available on your YouTube channel. So if you at all want to come there and watch it, you can come there and watch it, right? So okay, bye bye, take care. Thank you for listening.